Hello, everyone. This is Tom Fox. Welcome back to another episode of the Compliance Handbook. And you are in for a real treat today because I'm in for a real treat today. And I'm thrilled to have with me my good friend, Vince Walden. I've known Vince, I'm not quite sure how long, but Vince was one of the first people I came across who really talked about not simply data, but using data in a compliance program. So I asked Vince if he might be able to visit with me a little bit about what he's seen in the growth and use of data and data analytics. So Vince, first of all, for that incredibly long-winded introduction, thank you so much for taking the time to visit with me today.
Thank you. Glad to be on the show as always.
So what's your current role, Vince?
So I'm currently with Alvarez & Marcel's Disputes and Investigations Practice based in New York and have been there coming up on 2 years now.
So tell us a little bit, you're not a lawyer, so tell us a little bit about your professional background.
Yeah, no, not quite a lawyer. I work with lots of them or sometimes play one on TV. Now, I grew up, you know, in the accounting world, got my CPA license with Arthur Andersen back in the day, rode the Enron ship down with Arthur Andersen, and then started my career, left Arthur Andersen right before Enron hit and started a .com. And it's funny, I raised $500,000 through my old West Coast USC network friends and mentors. I spent $500,000. And thank God I sold the company for $500,000 during the .com boom. So that's kind of a funny story. Went right back to nice, safe Arthur Andersen 6 months before Enron hit. And then the rest is history. But then had been in Big Four ever since. KPMG acquired our practice. And then I left for EY in 2006, moved to Texas, made partner at EY in 2011, all the way to had a great run until 2019 where I joined A&M. So in a nutshell, been doing everything from damages and disputes to e-discovery to forensic data analytics, which was really the key differentiator in my career when FCPA started taking off back in 2009 and enforcement started taking off. I developed analytics to support that, and that essentially helped me make partner at EY.
So Vince, I've known a couple of folks like you who started out perhaps more in the fraud arena, but were pretty quickly able to see the strategies, tools, and even techniques you used in fraud detection and prevention really apply to compliance. I was wondering if you maybe could talk about that journey and how that led to data and data analytics and compliance.
You know, I think that's what happened. You know, we could all agree now that there were so much, you know, compliance was all about all of a sudden, you know, rewind 10 years, compliance was all about policies and procedures. And, you know, companies and counsel would be hired to develop those policies and procedures. But the big gap often was, how do you measure compliance effectiveness? What are the metrics? What's the accounting data? And, you know, not just simply did you take a training or not, but how do you measurably demonstrate compliance effectiveness? And through concepts like risk scoring and actually testing of the transactions, looking for improper payments. What always would scratch my head is and frustrate me was that there was so much work done to build proactive compliance programs. But when you investigated, when a company was investigated for FCPA, what was the first thing that they asked for? They wanted emails and they wanted the payments transactions. And, you know, why weren't we looking at those proactively? And that's really what drove my interest in building proactive compliance programs, because I saw so many FCPA investigations where that's, you know, finding those improper payments were what they were making and breaking the cases. And why can't we proactively look at that? And that was really what would drove a lot of my passion for building out these compliance program models.
Vince, when you started with these models, were you talking to sort of your CPA or internal audit colleagues in-house? Were you talking to the outside counsel who were perhaps leading an investigation, or you talk to in-house lawyers, someone like myself, either in the general counsel's office or the compliance officer? How did you sort of have that discussion about data and using data analytics to help ameliorate some of the frustrations you were feeling?
Yeah, you know, 10 years ago, my audience was always internal audit. And within good, well-organized companies with solid compliance programs, I often saw compliance sitting in the same room with internal audit. You know, we would have a anti-fraud or FCPA analytics kind of discussion. Internal audit was there and they would bring compliance, or we'd have it with compliance and they would bring internal audit, because internal audit understood the books and records. Compliance understood the legal risks, and really the magic was when the two worked together. That's how it started. And over the years, we've seen compliance become more mature, particularly over the last 2 to 3 years. They've become more mature and actually getting familiar with accounting or understanding what procure to pay is and payments and how invoices work and, you know, and how ERP systems like SAP or Oracle work. And really, that's the game changer. And I think the DOJ guidance that came out back in June of 2020 that we all know about, that was very accelerating. That accelerated a lot of the proactive discussions. And even I think earlier just this month, the June 3rd, I mean, even Biden did that announcement on, you know, increasing FCPA enforcement or making it a focus. So I think we still got a long ways to go, but compliance professionals will become more data driven as time goes on.
Vince, when you were at EY, you were either leading or part of a team that did several fairly high profile projects around proactive use of data analytics, not simply coming in after the fact and trying to figure out what happened. I was wondering if you could maybe describe generally a couple of the big projects that are in the public record that you worked on and how you're able to use those to not only convince your client to use them, but really help educate an audience of CCOs who have a legal background like myself.
Yeah, and I had worked with several companies, particularly in the pharmaceutical space, in the manufacturing space, wrote articles and collaboration articles with companies like GE and Johnson & Johnson. But perhaps one of my favorites, and I was just talking to my friend Matt Galvin this morning, was with AB InBev, Anheuser-Busch InBev's BrewRite platform. Which started out back in, 2016 and continued to grow. And that was an example of a compliance platform, which, again, my dream scenario is build the platform, train the team, get them self-sufficient and operational and phase out and let them run with it. And they did that with spades, and they've taken it almost to a life of their own now, where that was one probably that got a lot of recognition. A lot of people familiar on your show have heard of InBev's BrewRite platform and the risk scoring platform. What's interesting now is that platform, along with other companies, are thinking about this data sharing consortium. And I don't want to get off topic, but the idea of companies sharing their risk algorithms without having to share their data to build a better, more proactive data-driven compliance program and sharing best practices is something really exciting to me. And it's something that I know Matt Galvin is quite passionate about and building out with other compliance officers in other industries.
Vince, you mentioned the Department of Justice, and starting in 2017, back with Leslie Caldwell, in speeches, she started talking about data and data analytics. Then later there was the original evaluation of corporate compliance programs, largely written by Wei Chen, which was released in February of 2017. Later in 2019, we had the update to the evaluation, and you mentioned the 2020 update. Each one of those documents, and even starting back with Leslie Caldwell's speech, proactively talked about using data. And did this change the reception you were getting in the marketplace when the DOJ started talking about data analytics, and the CCO having access to data lakes in a company?
Yeah, you know, I think the June 2020, the most recent guidance that's out, was probably the most profound from a data-driven perspective, because it specifically said, and again, I'm not quoting from memory here, but you know, do you have sufficient access to operational transactional data sources? And that, you know, that was spot on. In fact, you know, as someone who's passionate about data analytics and, you know, doing a little bit of marketing myself, I could not have written a better marketing document for me, for me getting the message out. I mean, the DOJ did a great job nailing it. It was, you know, unequivocal. This is what they want. And so I reference that quite often. So, and again, previous versions were good, but they didn't really directly say transactional data, and do you have access to it? And not just point in time, but continuous. And that really stressed the proactive nature that was in the most recent guidance that made a difference. The other thing, if I could add real quick, Tom, interesting note, I know, you know, your audience and mine too on my podcast show, which you helped me found, was really compliance professionals. In the accounting world, there's COSO, Committee of Sponsoring Officers, Committee of Sponsoring, COSO is Committee of Sponsorship Organizations. I messed that up. But if you read the COSO Fraud Risk Management Guide that was developed by the ACFE and the Institute of Internal Audit, you know, COSO had input, ACFE had input, a whole bunch of bodies had input, and you read the DOJ guidance, it's not word for word the same, but if you read the categories of must have a risk assessment, must have governance, those two documents almost read the same. And it's interesting to note, attorneys haven't really read the COSO Fraud Risk Management Guide, and accountants really haven't read the DOJ guidance. And gosh, they say the same things. And to me, it's just really, it's profound that the two talk. And because I think, you know, and the two work together to build that data-driven platform. So I wouldn't just say the DOJ is an important thing. The COSO guidance is also important. So sorry if I digressed.
It's interesting you referenced. It's interesting you referenced COSO because I read that year after it came out in September of 2014. And when I read it, I said, it was like I had my road to Damascus moment and the scales fell from my eyes. And I said, who wrote this? This is for compliance.
Right.
Where did this come from?
Right. Well, I was one of the co-authors, but it was really a group of about 20 people, both in anti-fraud, accounting, and compliance coming together. So it's a great document, and it reads just like the DOJ.
Right. Well, let me take us to where you are now, Vince, because you mentioned you'd gone over to A&M, and you've created actually some very interesting tools at A&M. So could you tell us about the tool you created and how it can be used in one of the most interesting proactive manners?
Yeah, you know, interesting. In my prior experience in the Big Four, it was difficult to develop platforms and get the investment that I needed to build those proactive compliance monitoring platforms to the scale and level that I needed to. And it's been, I've just been having a ball over the past 2 years. I'll say building my dream platform. I'm working with some companies now that have allowed me to pull this to pull the kind of that dream compliance monitoring platform together. In fact, we'll be announcing our relationship with a company called Spectrum Data Science and building what we're branding as the digital twin service, A&M Digital Twin. And what that allows us to do is cost-effectively, and that's key, cost-effectively pull in client-relevant payments data, risk score and prioritize every month in a cost-effective way. And really what that means is, what used to take me 300 plus hours of staff time to pull payments data out of a system, do all the mathematical gymnastics, put it in a database and build out reports, now takes me less than 30 hours. So imagine that's a 10x reduction in time, which is also a 10x reduction in fees. So I can do this super cost effectively, sometimes for less than $25,000 to get the data online and running for an entire organization, and then refresh it monthly on an automated basis. Now, we can do it in the cloud, we can put it on site with clients. And so one of the things I'm having a great time with is working with clients to get them on this platform and being able to benchmark and show month to month improvements. And if we see something risky, it gets flagged. If we see it improving, that's a great thing. And we call this kind of that continuous compliance monitoring, I think, which is just in line with what I think the DOJ is setting in their guidance.
What's been the reception in the marketplace for you, Vince?
It's been great. Every time that I show this to clients, it's, oh my gosh, I want it. let me put this in place. And so I think it's been very positive. It's just a function of getting, as we get out of post-COVID, companies wanting to allocate the resources and the time. But again, as I stressed, it doesn't take a lot of time. It takes, you know, maybe a couple hours a month of compliance officer or, you know, compliance team review time, because it's basically answers the question, who are my top 20 riskiest vendors? Who are my top 20 riskiest employees? Or who are, what are my top 15 to 20 riskiest transactions and why? What risk triggers are they hitting? And then find me more like this based on, as I tag and have case management, you know, find me statistically similar transactions next time so the system can learn. It's kind of everything I wanted in my in a compliance platform.
So Vince, as you look down the road into 2025 and beyond, are there any trends you see that the compliance function, the CCO, or compliance professionals really need to be aware of going forward?
You know, I'm really excited about that concept of a consortium. I really think that's where it's going to go. It's something that I know Matt Galvin is pushing it with the BrewRite platform, and he's bringing in other companies and technology companies. I think by the time this airs, it will be announced that he's got Wei Chen on the board of that consortium to help form it and steer it in the right direction, and he's bringing on some really good industry leaders to convince them to anonymously and safely share their findings and observations into a centralized repository such that they can benefit from the schemes and the risk triggers that other companies might be suffering from, so that we all learn and then we can all improve. So that, you know, hey, what's the risk algorithm for predicting a risky or government entity? Let's say, what are those algorithms, you know, regardless of the industry? I think that consortium concept by 2025 will be quite mature. I think it's kind of a 2022 thing that's going to start. And for companies, particularly in the Fortune 500, we'll see more of those start up. I think data-driven compliance is here to stay. I think attorneys will become more familiar with accounting concepts, and accountants will become more familiar with legal and risk concepts. And I think the future overall looks very bright for legal and compliance professionals, because the technology proportion brings a lot of transparency and visibility in the business that other business functions will recognize in terms of business transparency and maintaining an integrity environment.
Vince, we're unfortunately coming up near the end of our time, but before we get to the end, I wanted to ask you, you do have a podcast. It's on the Compliance Podcast Network. It's appropriately named the Walden Pond. But what I'm really intrigued with, what have you gotten out of that podcast? Not simply, you know, what do your listeners get, but I find the satisfaction in what I receive from talking to people is as much as anything. But I wanted to ask you, what have you gotten out of your podcast?
Well, thank you, Tom. And again, that was, you know, back in 2019, I think you were the one to suggest it. You helped me produce it. And here I am, I think 35 episodes later, still running strong. And I think the funnest part was the ability to talk to really interesting people. I think, you know, being part of the, you know, having the Walden Pond on compliance and being on the Compliance Podcast Network has given me access to people from some great companies that I wouldn't have ordinarily been able to kind of just talk to out of the door. And it's allowed me to interview some fascinating people on some really interesting topics. And to me, again, this sounds kind of shallow, but I get the biggest high when one of my podcast shows, you know, gets 2,000 or 3,000 views or lots of likes, and I know that people are listening to it and enjoying it. And so for those, you know, those that want to welcome me on the pond, I'll be waiting for you.
Well, we're going to link to the Walden Pond in the show notes as well, Vince, but I was wondering if our listeners wanted any more information about any of the topics you've talked about or even the tools you've developed at A&M, where could they go?
They can certainly email me. I'd love to hear from the audience, vwalden@alvarezandmarcel.com. You can also Google the Walden Pond on compliance to get access to the show, and my contact information's there. Or Google A&M Digital Twin. I think we're two or three links just below. I think GE owns the domain of digital twin, but you'll see A&M digital twin for more information on some of the analytics things that we're working on as well.
Well, Vince, as I said, I really wanted to do this interview with you for quite some time. I'm really thrilled that we were able to get it scheduled and get it done. And I hope that perhaps I can call upon you again for where we might be down the road.
Always a pleasure, Tom, and wish you the best. And again, we have I love our audience. Again, we kind of share the same audience on the Compliance Podcast Network. It's a dynamic profession and people are always quite interested and enthusiastic. So always a pleasure.